Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome to the worship of our Lord God. We are going to be focusing today on what you might call breathing. Spiritual breathing. The only way you can stay alive is by breathing, right? The only way you can stay alive as a Christian is by breathing out your sins. We call that confession. And then breathing in forgiveness. We call that forgiveness. So, to help us breathe better today, that's why we're here. That's what we're going to be focusing on today. All the hymns, all the readings, the message today. And we'll begin by singing, Speak, O Lord, your servant is listening. It hears you, 735.
And failed to do what is good. For this I deserve
sins.
And trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given His only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for us and our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by His, not mine, by His authority, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
For all that we need in life, and for the wisdom to use all your gifts with gratitude and joy, hear our prayer, O Lord. That nothing can separate us from your love, and for the courage to stand firm against the assaults of Satan and every evil. Hear our prayer, O Christ. For the well-being of your holy church and all the world, and for those who offer here their worship and praise, hear our prayer, O Lord. Preserver of life, uphold us by your power and keep us in your tender care. The works of the Lord are great and glorious, let us praise his name forever.
Two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor.
The rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe girl lamb he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come to him. David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die. He must pay for that lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity." Then Nathan said to David, "You are the man." This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. "I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms. I gave you the house of Israel and Judah, and if all this had been too little, I would have given you even more. Why did you despise the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with a sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now therefore the sword will never depart from your house because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your own." But David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." Nathan replied, "The Lord has taken away your sin. You're not going to die. But because by doing this you have made the enemies of the Lord show utter contempt, the son born to you will die." After Nathan had gone home, the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife had born to David, and he became ill. We read Psalm 32. We sing the responses we say responsibly the Psalm. Psalm 32 on page 78. Doubting God's grace and gospel, and believing that we have to do more, or we should have done a whole lot less to be saved. If you've ever felt this way, this scripture's for you. When Peter came to Antioch, I, Paul, opposed him to the face, his face, because he was clearly in the wrong. Before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter in front of them all, "You are a Jew, and yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? We who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by observing the law. Because by observing the law, no one will be justified. If while we seek to be justified in Christ, it becomes evident that we ourselves are sinners, does that mean that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroyed, if I prove that I'm a lawbreaker, or through the law I died to the law so that I might live for God, I've been crucified with Christ. And I no longer live. Lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. Here is our second lesson. Hallelujah. May your priests be clothed with righteousness. May your saints sing for joy. Hallelujah. With her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, for the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you that her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved, or as proof of her forgiveness, she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. He had said that before to her somehow, and he said it again. The other guests began to say among themselves, who is this that even forgives sins? Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Here ends our gospel.
Psalms, most of them, gave
man of the Lord's own heart, rich, powerful, absolute authority over life and death of his people, the best supporter of the congregation of Israel that anybody could find, first in talents, generous in talents, time, treasure. Even David had to be told, you're the one, because he had deliberately, willfully, intentionally sinned. And so God sent Nathan to him, an Old Testament prophet, an Old Testament pastor, an Old Testament Christian, to tell him a story, a parable, and invited in a friendly way for David to react to what he heard. So Nathan tells him that there was this certain poor man who had practically no material wealth, but he had one thing, a ewe lamb, a girl lamb, and he treated it like part of his family. He ate from his own plate off the table, he drank from his own cup, the milk, the water that he drank, he slept in his arm, he treated it like a daughter. And then there was a certain rich man who lived close by, who had all kinds of sheep and goats and lambs, and one day a traveler came to the rich man, and in those days you showed hospitality lavishly. Even today, the Bedouins in the nomads in Israel today show that kind of hospitality, where they will feed you and give you a bunk to sleep in, and they will converse with you, and they will make you relax. And if you got any animals, they'll feed them for 5 days straight before they ask you to pitch in. So it was like that at this time. The man was going to lavishly entertain him and give him a great meal. But he didn't want to take one of his own lambs from his remaining. So he went up to the poor man and he took that one little girl lamb, butchered it, roasted it, and gave it to his guests. Nice hospitality. David's reaction, he burned with anger. He said, this man deserves to die because of his lack of pity, and before he dies, he needs to pay back that guy four times as much. David quite figured quite comfortably, safely, maybe even a little self-righteously, at another rich man. I mean, for a poor man to covet a rich man's wealth, and part of it is wrong but understandable, but for a rich man to covet the one poor little thing of a for a rich man to cover the one thing of a poor man and then take it, that's monstrous. And even David could see that. And then as David's talking, pointing, God through Nathan turns the tables. You're the man. You're the one. David, you. And can you imagine the blush of guilt and shame walking up David's neck as he heard that phrase? This was all supposed to be a secret. What he had done with Bathsheba that one night, the wife of Uriah. It had been more than 9 months since that time. And a little bit longer than that since he had collaborated with his commander-in-chief of his armies, Joab, to take Uriah, the husband of Bathsheba, and as a soldier, and put him in the front lines, and then step away from him and let the enemy kill him, and then that's what happened, and that was murder. But for over 9 months, nothing happened. There was no lightning bolt out of the sky coming down. There was no obvious divine intervention from God. It seemed like the workers of iniquity do get away with it. And then here comes Nathan, you're the man. You're the one. And then Nathan recalled some history for David to ponder, the history of God's interacting with him So you can see who he was sinning against, the God who had set him up and made him king over the house of Jacob, house of Israel, the house of Judah, combined them into one big nation, a great nation of Israel, who had given him smashing success upon smashing success, who had delivered him from the murderous hands of the former king Saul, and had given it into his hands as he became king, the wives, the harem of King Saul. And here's, of course, where we need to stop, because that's kind of bothering. Multiple wives? In the Old Testament, God's leaders a lot of times have multiple wives. Abraham did. Hagar was her name. At the same time, he had Sarah. And then there was Jacob, Rachel, Leah. And after it was David. So we know that God allowed that to happen. We know that he did not condone it. You know why we know? We know he did not condone it in the Old Testament. Because wherever there were multiple wives, there was tension in the family. There was stress in the family. There was unhappiness. There was jealousy. There were consequences. Reaping what you sow. And furthermore, in the New Testament, God specifically says about overseers, about pastors, that they shall be the husband of but one wife. And we know that that didn't apply just to pastors, because in 1 Peter 5, it says, you guys who are shepherds and pastors, you set the example for the flock to follow, to copy you, to do what you do. So they were supposed to do the same thing. And finally, there's more, but finally for today, Matthew 19, Jesus quotes the Genesis model of marriage, of one man and one woman, and the man being united to his wife and becoming the two becoming one flesh. And he quotes that in Matthew 19 as the immutable will of God for all times, Old Testament times and New Testament times, okay? So now we move on with the narrative. In spite of the many blessings that David received from the hand of this very gracious God, he did what was displeasing to this God. He didn't care what God thought. David had despised the Lord by doing what was evil in his sight. He committed adultery with Bathsheba, got her pregnant, and then had Uriah the Hittite, her husband, murdered to cover it up, and then married her real quick. Again, to cover it up, real quick. David, a man of many, rich man of many, took away the one from the poor man. And he was going to be judged for it. And Nathan lined it up for him. Number one, as you have used the sword of the Amorites to do your dirty work and murder, so the sword of death will never depart from your house. It will always be at war. Number one. Number two, as you have shamefully used the wife of another man is going to shamefully use your wife, your wives. And that's what happened in the rebellion of his own son Absalom against him later on down the line. And thirdly, even after he repented, because he gave such a horrible, offensive example for his people to follow, God said that son born from that adulterous relationship is going to die. David's reaction, not normal, paranormal, supernatural, really, said, I've sinned against the Lord. You know what they call that in the Bible? Repentance. Turnaround time. Turnaround time. David would suffer for his sins. He would suffer tragedies in his life. In 7 days from this announcement of Nathan, his son would die. The son that came from that relationship that night, though he went to heaven. And so repentance comes because God saw, and David saw, God's wrath was real. Repentance comes because a person sees that God's wrath is in real time. And it's mercy. Also, over-the-top mercy that David saw and drove him to repentance. Mercy. Here was a guy that God specifically selected and called and sent in. He had to bring to do this. tell David to call him out, to call him back. This was mercy. Call him out, call him back, drain the pus out of his soul, and he did have a lot of pus in his soul. David describes it in Psalm 32. We used parts of Psalm 32 in our psalm today. But listen how David describes how he felt before he came clean with his sin, before he confessed his sin. He said, "When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand, O God, was heavy upon me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer." In other words, David's guilt drained him physically, emotionally, mentally. And when David confessed his sin and when he came clean, God made sure that there was a prophet just right there on the spot giving him absolution. Absolution. The Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die. The Lord has taken away your sin. And when Nathan dropped that bombshell of beautiful good news, there was huge relief. Listen to the way David describes it again in Psalm 32. He says, "Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. You forgave what made me feel so drawn down." That was merciful. To be called out, to be called back. And so is it merciful. So is it merciful when the Lord sends somebody into your life with a Bible passage and gets you to understand how the Word of God applies to you, and that you're the one who needs to repent. You are the one. Merciful God it is who does such an intervention. Of course, our reaction, our normal reaction to someone who brings something out of the dark into the light is to say, you know, who made you my judge? Or simply, who me? Who me? How could it possibly be me? We see sin and the faults and the feelings and the lack of compassion in other people so easily. Not so easy to see in ourselves. When we are faced with a lot, when we are faced with being unloving, when we are faced with being harsh, when we are faced with speaking evil against someone, when we are faced with saying getting drunk or getting too many drinks in our belly and being mean, sexually immoral, that it's just so easy to say, it wasn't really me. Like, who was it? Like, who was it? The old Adam and Eve nature is so there when you're faced with our own sin. I did it, Lord, but it was the woman. I did it, Lord, but it was the serpent. Really, therefore, it wasn't my fault. I was the victim here. Now, I'm not talking about real victims where evil people have pushed themselves intentionally, purposely on a person who wants nothing part of it, but all of a sudden now becomes part of their sin, part of their shame, and feels as if they're the sinner, whereas the real sinner is the one who's pushed it upon them. I'm not talking about those people. Those people have got a very special place in God's heart of grace. I'm talking about people who just use the victim card and say, you know, everybody does it. Or he started it, or she started it. Circumstances were beyond my control, and that's why I did it. I'm not talking about true victims. I'm talking about the people who don't want to take responsibility for what they're doing. They don't get away with that kind of stuff. Adam and Eve did. They got kicked out of the garden. He got kicked out of paradise. David never went there. David never went there, did he? It's a beautiful confession. He just simply said, "I have sinned against the Lord." No ifs, buts, and ands. Beautiful confession. That's the way to confess your sins. I did it. I did it. If it's done by me, I did it. No ifs, buts, and ands. In order to fear God, we need to know that there are terrible consequences for sin. We do. We need to know that. When we fall into open sins, sins that don't remain in the heart, then we lose faith. Then we lose the Holy Spirit. Then the Holy Spirit and faith just go away. It's written in 1 John chapter 3. No one who lives in God keeps on sinning. No one who is born of God will continue to sin. We cannot go on sinning. Though it is also true that if we say we have no sin, the truth is not in us. It's written again, you must keep hold of the deep truths of faith with a clear conscience. So when there's a bad conscience, where somebody is constantly going against their conscience, there can be no faith. 1 Corinthians 6 says, the sexually immoral and the adulterer will not inherit the kingdom of God. 1 Corinthians 6 is talking about someone who's continually in his sin, living in his sin. And for such a person is obviously then a plainly impenitent and is not a Christian and will not inherit the kingdom of God. So the big question is, when David was living in his sin, when he was covering up his sin, when he wasn't coming clean, when he was hiding his sin, did he lose faith? Did he lose the Holy Spirit? Would he have gone to hell before Nathan had come to him? And the answer is yes. Let none of us dare to think that we can stand before God with an evil conscience, a conscience intending evil, and be accepted by God. Let none of us dare to think that we can plan on doing some evil and pray to God and get answered. Not going to happen. It would be insane for any one of us to believe that we can and we should forgive someone who comes up to us and says, you know, I want your forgiveness, brother. I want your forgiveness, sister, even though I plan on keeping on doing what I've been doing to you. You wouldn't forgive that. You shouldn't forgive that person, neither would God. You know, it's different if we stumble into sin. Where all of a sudden I get so irritated that I commit some sin and then I realize I have sinned and I cry to God for forgiveness, but that doesn't cancel faith. But you know from experience that if you give in to sin, if you yield to sin, God instantly feels far. Because deliberate, willful sin kills faith. You know, you can deceive yourself for a while. You can lie to your wife or your husband. You can cheat your employer for a while. You can pretend that the bad stuff you did hasn't really happened. You can slide in some evil pleasures of this world behind your parents' back. But God knows. God keeps track. And God will punish. He will make it happen that what you sow is what you reap. You know what? Wake you up, to bring you back, to remind you though that though he is compassionate and loving and slow to anger and forgives wickedness, rebellion, and sin, he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes. Somebody once said it this way. It was Martin Luther. God forgives sins, but he doesn't permit sins. And again, he does that He gets it. He gets an intervention going through someone, through someone's actions, through a word of scripture like today's, a very specific place, a very specific time in your life, and touches your heart because you're the one he loves. Because you're the one that he wants with him forever. Because you're the one that he acts as if he cannot live without. In fact, he died for you. For you, not just the world, because you are part of the world. You're the one he wants with him forever. Peace of God that passes all human understanding, your hearts and minds and faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's confess our God-given faith in words now, the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. Amen.
these offerings be a sign what many people forget, that it is more blessed to give than to receive. In Jesus' name, amen. We also pray. Lord, we have sinned. We have gone astray. For today's scripture, we can see again that you punish all those who transgress your commandments. Therefore, we fear you and your anger. Because sin will bite us in the back. But give us strength so that we do not disobey what you command. And because we see again that your promise is a promise of grace, repentance and forgiveness through Jesus. And we see again that every blessing is there if you do your will. Help us to trust in you. Trust in what you say and gladly obey what you command. For those of us about to take your Holy Supper, thank you for such a gracious meal, such a powerful meal that transmits total forgiveness and power to say no to sin. Thank you, Lord. Show us how to love you more. Show us how to love others more, for Jesus' sake. Amen. And in your name, Jesus, we also humbly but confidently pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. He sends the Holy Spirit to testify that we are His children and to strengthen us when we are weak. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of His Christ. To Him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever. which have praised you here may glorify you in the world. That the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again. And that all who have here received in his true body and blood the pledge of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with each other. Serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Ah, immediately following church today, the ladies would like help moving all the stuff down the basement over to one side, right after church. And then Pastor Swanson would like to move into the parsonage July 14th, or the 4th of July, weekend. And we got to get it in gear, because we're not ready. We stripped three bedrooms, the wallpaper off of three bedrooms, or three rooms. And they have to be, the walls have to be washed. And there's four rooms that have to be painted. The dining room doesn't have to be washed, but it does all have to be painted. What I was looking for was if a family or an extended family would like to take on a room or whatever and commit to this, we need to get it in gear. Floyd has the staircase out of the house right now. He's redoing it so it's not so steep. So we can't get to the two bedrooms upstairs, but we can do the kitchen and the dining room. So anybody, give me a call. We'll make arrangements. We need to get it done. Thank you.
So we could afford it.
Thank you.